Croatia, a European country located in the Mediterranean. A treasure trove of culture and architecture with a long history, a stunning coastline and more than 1,000 islands, ancient buildings, Christian churches, Venetian cities and colourful traditions. Zagreb is its political and cultural focal point. An amiable capital city situated at the intersection of Central, Eastern and Southern Europe. Zagreb originated in the Middle Ages from two rival settlements on neighboring hills. The Kaptol district has been its Catholic heart since the Middle Ages, an atmospheric place, Upper Town being a gem of its historic past. The city's cathedral is its largest house of worship and it dominates the capital, its two steeples towering above the old city. Thirteen hundred years ago, the Episcopal Church maintained contact with the Holy See in Rome. The cathedral grounds and Franciscan monastery are also well worth a visit. According to legend, the cathedral was founded by St. Francis of Assisi following his return from the East. Just a few steps away, an old lane that is now a pedestrian zone. The actual center of Upper Town is Marcus Court with its splendid church. The stone gate with a portrait of Mary has always separated the Upper Town from the Lower Town. The stone road leads up to the old town square and to the Jesuit court with its impressive fountain, the water-spouting Fisherman with Snake. Following a devastating earthquake, the stone figures of four evangelists and Holy Katharina were set within the church facade. Krivavi Mošt, or Blood Bridge, was for centuries the natural border between Upper Town and Lower Town. The Church of Mary was formerly situated on a creek, and the Cistercians, the original builders of both church and monastery, bathed here. Next to the city centre is the vast Dolak marketplace, a colourful mix of Central and Southern Europe and the Balkans. Overlooking the Lower Town, Strossmayer Promenade was built following the demolition of the southern city wall. It ends at Lostrischak Tower. Since 1899, the Uspunjača cable car has connected the Upper Town to the Lower Town, a cable car with a long tradition. Now, Lower Town. We explore the Ilija by tram. This busy street encircles the city and travels between its two main districts. The Ilija leads to the British court, where each Sunday a well-attended flea market is held. At Flower Place, Petar Preradovic awaits. And the National Theatre, designed by architects Fellner and Helmer, dominates the centre of Tito Square. The city's marvellous botanical garden is located in the south and contains an array of wonderful natural sights. An imposing arcaded facade forms the entrance to the Mirogoj Cemetery. This final resting place, laid out as a park, is an artistic masterpiece. The medieval Medvedgrad Fortress is a most striking and fascinating attraction in the Medvednica Natural Park in front of the city gates. A unique journey through this city and its history ends here. North of Zagreb, on the western border with Slovenia, a picture-perfect castle rises on a hill. Veliki Tabor. Its Renaissance courtyard with columns and arcades has a touch of southern elegance. When the castle was taken over by the Ratka family, its dark interior was transformed into a comfortable and luxurious residence. But a number of things continue to recall the austerity of the 15th century, which explains its imposing appearance. Kumrovec, birthplace of the former President of Yugoslavia, Josip Broz Tito, is located south of the castle and is now a museum village. During Tito's lifetime, his birthplace was transformed into a museum, a place of both history and nostalgia. Following the death of Tito, various old farmhouses, granaries, stables and dwellings were added. The result is a fine museum village which accurately depicts rural life in Zagorje at the end of the 19th century. Close by is the snow-white, fairy tale-like Trogoštin Castle, set above an artificial lake. Its core is formed by a 700-year-old fort, which fell into disrepair following the wars against the Turks. It was renovated in the 19th century. Count Jorak Dratskovic took over the property and transformed the old fortress into a Gothic fantasy. With original furnishings and a hunting hall. This residential castle was modeled on similar ones in Germany. However, the huge financial cost of it led the Count to the brink of bankruptcy. Only its gradual conversion to a museum saved the day. In the south, the Istrian Peninsula is the pearl of the Adriatic. Umag is the center of its tourist coastline. Oblivious to holidaymakers, the local fishermen continue to go about their work, and in the harbor, their boats await the next trip out to sea. The fishing village has now become a tourist resort, and the bay's promenade is popular with the region's many tourists. The Romans founded the settlement of Umakus in a tiny bay. From this, a small town developed, and in 1268 it fell to Venice. The town's narrow lanes and ancient stone buildings exude a Mediterranean atmosphere, although a feeling of medieval times is always present. Food and drink are also popular outside the gates of the old town, and especially seafood restaurants. The city's well-conserved walls and towers were built in the 14th century. Further south along the Adria coast, Poreč is picturesquely situated on a peninsula. and its city hall reveals much of its history. As Istria's first city, in 1267 Poreč was affiliated to the Serenissima, and palaces, squares and religious buildings were constructed. But Poreč is also famous for this early Byzantine masterpiece, the Euphrasius Basilica. Arcades frame the atrium of the church complex, which is considered to be the most important architectural ensemble in Croatia. Next to the former Bishop's Palace. Here, church treasures are on display, and in the basement, ancient tombs. The small garden next to the bishop's residence is covered with the remains of a mosaic floor from the oratory of the Holy Maurus. The highlight of the complex is the basilica's large interior with its magnificent apsis mosaics, whose variety of vivid color is a magnificent sight. Poreč is a little gem with a great history and culture, and even today, pearl of the Adriatic. The historic center of Rovinj is located on a shell-shaped peninsula further south on the Adriatic coast. Seen from the sea, it's one of the most stunning of the Adriatic's harbor cities. Harmonious and compact, a perfect cityscape. The buildings with their colourful, shining facades are densely packed. A bell tower marks the high point. Next, the Santa Eufemia Basilica, Venetian Baroque all round. Harmonic architecture and fine works of art. And the stone sarcophagus of the saint whose bones are stored and worshipped here. The Campanile is the highest bell tower in Istria. The wonderful view from here is just reward for the adventurous climb up the 60-meter high tower. Rovinj has always been a much sought-after place. And it has remained so until today. The romantic pearl of the Croatian Riviera has lost nothing of its original charm. Rovinj is both history and culture. Ferry boats travel from Fazzana to an archipelago of 14 islands once well loved by the Romans. Monks built early Christian churches and monasteries in this secluded region. Often on the foundations of late Roman summer palaces. More. The Brijuni Islands were a restricted area during Josip Tito's lifetime. The Yugoslav president recognized their recreational and historic value. This malarial swamp was transformed into his private residence. On the west coast of the peninsula and located above the Dobrika Gulf are the sprawling ruins of a huge Byzantine castrum. Within its walls was a small town that was inhabited up until the 16th century. Its foundations are still in good condition. Situated close to the southern tip of the Istrian Peninsula is Pula, the oldest city on Croatia's eastern Adriatic coast. The largest square of the old town and today's main square was originally located on the site of a Roman forum. Next to the town hall is the well-preserved Temple of Augustus that dates back to 14 AD and was dedicated to the Roman Emperor. However, Pula was first mentioned in conjunction with the founding of the town by the Argonauts. Here too followed the Romans, the power of Constantinople, and finally Venice. The city has been influenced by each of these eras. Miraculously, the town's monumental Roman amphitheatre has remained intact and is now one of the six largest and most well-preserved examples of its kind. In the ancient Roman Empire, amphitheatres were extremely popular, and the traditional bread and games benefited the reign of the Roman emperors. The gigantic amphitheatre accommodated 23,000 spectators. It must have been a breathtaking sight. Pula is an intriguing blend of history. Inland, visible from afar and romantically perched on a hill, is probably the most famous village in Istria, Motovun. Its lush hillside vineyards are reminiscent of Tuscany. Typical narrow lanes, stone buildings, and the original wall that dates back to the 13th century still surround the old town and castle. The ring-shaped medieval town grew up to the bell tower. The Sveti Stjepan Church and its battlements make it appear like a castle keep. It also served as a defensive tower. Here too, in the remote hinterland, various power struggles took place, but it was Venice that added its own architectural stamp with both an inner and outer defensive wall. The impression of a fort refuge has remained. In the fertile countryside lies yet another Istrian gem, Hum, the smallest town in the world. With its well-preserved gate, cobblestones and single lane. The Sveti Jeronim gate and fortified bell tower are also situated in an elevated position. The town's few inhabitants are like one large family. They live within the medieval ambience of this town of sand and limestone and mainly work on the land. During the day, the town appears empty as many of its inhabitants work in the fields beyond. But all of this was once so different. This fortified town was formerly a heavily defended border station between Venetia and Habsburg. At Lovran, we arrive at Kvarna Bay. The town is a small peninsula and was once dependent upon the Kingdom of Croatia, the Patriarchate of Aquileia, the Count of Pazin, and from 1374, the Habsburg monarchy. Lovran was favored in Roman times as a summer residence, and in the Middle Ages both shipping and trade flourished here. Many well-preserved 17th and 18th century buildings form the heart of the old town. Today, it contains the ambience of a K&K summer residence and Mediterranean fishing port. The city's name is derived from the laurel trees, which grow in abundance on the surrounding slopes of Gorica Hill and along the coast. From Lovran, the 12-kilometer-long beach promenade of Lungomare leads north and finally ends in Opatija. At the time of the Austro-Hungarian Empire, this, formerly Abbazia, was one of the most frequently visited resorts of the monarchy. Its elegance is a reminder of bygone days. A meeting place of European nobility, bankers, and prominent artists. An elite that disappeared with the demise of the monarchy. However, the atmosphere of the Belle Epoque lives on. Opatija has blossomed, an atmospheric place. Its return to comfort, tradition, and discerning visitors has led to the successful restoration of both townscape and buildings. In the once most fashionable seaside resort on the Adriatic, our visit to the eastern Istrian coast comes to an end. Almost next door, Rijeka, the largest port in Croatia, gateway to the Mediterranean. Founded by the Liburnians, conquered by the Celts, and named Tasatica by the Romans. In the harbour are the old buildings of the Habsburg era, and reliefs and sculptures with nautical motifs that adorn its ochre facades. Rijeka was prosperous and the eighth largest port in Europe. Much has changed, but the famous port city continues to be vibrant. With a splendid skyline. An archway under a clock tower leads to the oldest part of the city, at the center of which is the Church of Holy Vitus. Here too, well-preserved reliefs from the time of the monarchy, in contrast to the city's main shopping street. The island of Rab is the most charming and greenest of the Gavana Islands. With a turbulent history of power struggles. The Romanesque cathedral in the eponymous capital of Rab is the island's most important monument. In 1177, Pope Alexander III personally inaugurated its construction. A climb to the top of the 13th century bell tower is well worth the effort and provides a great view of the old town. On a narrow tongue of land, it juts into the blue sea like the bow of a ship, and the stone buildings press against each other and frame the small harbour. Four steeples rise high up into the sky like the masts of a ship. And in between, the remains of medieval monasteries that were once connected to the churches. The Karifront Peninsula has a wooden face. And the beach at Kampur has developed into the hot spot of the island. Seafaring and trade once made Rab rich, until in 1456 the plague arrived and brought about its decline. However, tourism is beginning to prosper here. The border area to Bosnia-Herzegovina is a fine place, with deep blue and turquoise green lakes, the cascading waters of Plitvice, and the Plitvica Jezera National Park. For 7 kilometers, 16 lakes have formed within a gorge like the links of a chain, connected by various cascades and waterfalls. A tiny wonderworld of forests and water, Laika, land of the wolf. A geological miracle occurred here, a natural harmony of both water and rock. Four thousand years ago, tiny organisms began their work. Mosses, algae and bacteria were covered by seawater minerals that gradually formed layers of travertin. If lime is deposited for sufficient time, it can petrify plants and completely transform them. Over thousands of years, huge dams of porous material form, which eventually solidify. A number of bridges and paths lead through the park, and on the largest lake, the Jezero Kostjak, boat trips are available. Also, bus trains travel alongside the lakes. This natural paradise within the heart of Croatia has lost nothing of its original beauty. A watery oasis in the countryside, amid dry karst. The southern strip of the Adriatic Mediterranean coast is known as Dalmatia. A land gate forms the entrance to the North Dalmatian port of Zadar, a splendid city located on a peninsula. 3,000 years of history from antiquity to the KNK monarchy welcomes all those who come here. The circular Sveti Donat Church was originally a Roman temple. In the 9th century, monks constructed a religious building above that of a former Juno sanctuary. The central building seems to be more Roman martial than Christian sacral, possibly as a symbol against paganism. Next, the bell tower of the Sveta Stoshija. And a good view of the old town. Within the city walls, there are palaces, historic villas, archaeological remains, and many small places of interest, such as the place of the five fountains, a good source of water. Further south, and situated in the hinterland, Vransko Jezero is Croatia's largest inland waterway. The lake was once twice as large, but in order to create farmland, a channel was dug between the lake and the sea to drain off much of the water. However, However, the lake is a unique biotope and the marsh on its northern shore is a conservation area where many waterfowl breed. More than 100 different species spend the winter here, a fact that attracts bird watchers from all over the world. A ferry travels from the small coastal town of Biograd to Pashman Island, a popular weekend destination for those living on the mainland. This green garden island is still fairly undiscovered. Monks still inhabit the ideally situated Benedictine monastery of Sveti Kozma I Damjan. The abbey, built in 1125, was a center of Glagolitsa, and a small museum contains artifacts from this period. The nearby Franciscan monastery of Sveti Kraj provides both refreshment and accommodation. The monasteries were built as fortress-like island refuges when hostile Venice occupied the country's coastal cities. Further off the coast in the Adriatic Mediterranean is the bizarre yet wonderful world of Kornati. The only way to discover it is by boat. To its stony areas that are now a national park, with 147 islands and cliffs, a picturesque paradise. A unique labyrinth in the Mediterranean. Now, Dugi Otok Island, well known for two natural phenomena. Its mile-long and up to 160-meter-high white coastal cliffs, and the Mir Jezero, a saltwater lake which is always around 6 degrees warmer than the sea. Next, we travel to several large, bare, rocky islands, sinkholes, caves, and craggy coastlines. The Kornati were formed by a natural sinking of the coast, about a meter every 1,000 years, the sea filling former valleys. In ancient times, the islands were forested, but eventually the Illyrians cut down the trees in order to use the timber for shipbuilding. There are almost no trees here, and the Dinaric karst soon engulfs any rainfall. Back on the mainland, in the hinterland of Šibenik, the Krka River and its dammed-up lakes and waterfalls form the natural border between both north and central Dalmatia. For around 10,000 years, the river's constant interplay of both erosion and sedimentation has been subject to constant change. The Krka River and its cascades is a natural karst phenomenon. It not only cuts canyons into the rock, but also deposits the resultant debris from the limestone and thus forms several natural barriers. The Manolovacki Slap is the park's most beautiful and largest waterfall. The Skradinsky Buk, the longest. Again and again, the waters become spectacular travertine waterfalls and consist of ravvakan, natural barriers, islands and small lakes. Here, nature has created a wonder world of water. On the Mediterranean coast, one of Dalmatia's most beautiful cities is situated within a sheltered bay, the medieval city of Šibenik. Sveti Jakov, the Holy Jakob Cathedral, was its architectural masterpiece, and today the most important sacred Renaissance building in Dalmatia. The interior of the cathedral looks somewhat gloomy, but its generous dimensions and mighty 32-meter-high dome are truly impressive. A large wheel window provides light. Close to the court of the Republic, and also next to the cathedral, is the Venetian City Loggia, where the city senate once met. The nearby Rector's Palace now contains the City Museum. It features various splendid archaeological finds that date from Neolithic times to Illyrian antiquity. Šibenik extends in terraces across a steep slope, and the maze of narrow streets in the historic center of the city has a truly medieval atmosphere. Outside the remains of the double city walls and a Franciscan church is a small monastery garden. An island of tranquility that was not founded by mariners. Around 30 kilometers southeast, Primorsten is situated on a peninsula, tranquil blue water all around. Its solid walls and narrow streets date back to its early settlement days in the 16th century, when those from the inland fled here from the Turks. Their small buildings were built of broken stone and covered with coarse slate plates. Surrounded by pine trees, Sveti Jurat Church is the highest point of the city. Its radiant campanile can be seen from far and wide. The picturesque old city of Trogir is situated on a small island which is connected to the mainland by a bridge and protected by sturdy walls and a fortress. First, Greeks from Issa settled here and founded the fortified city of Tragirion. Under the Romans, it became a thriving commercial port. Later the Croats followed, then hostilities by the Saracens and Tatars, until Venice took over and the imposing Camerlengo fortress was built for the governor and his troops. The south gate leads to another world. And now, our journey to the Middle Ages can begin. A small main square leads to the Cathedrale Sveti Lovro, dedicated to St. Laurentinus and the city's main landmark. Guarded by stone lions. Almost 500 years of construction was spent on this sacred building, whose central nave is divided by two rows, each containing four pillars. Opposite the cathedral is the 15th century Cipico Palazzo, the most beautiful building in the square. a traditional residence that belonged to a wealthy merchant family, with a matching inner courtyard framed by arcades. Each stone bears witness to history, as well as to Trogir's former prosperity and importance as the center of the region. Tourists come here from all over the world. Today, Split is the financial and cultural center of Dalmatia. The origin and importance of this city dates back to Roman Emperor Diocletian. After ruling for 20 years and planning for his retirement, he wanted to build a grand property near to his hometown of Salona, a palace along the lines of a Roman castrum. The palace subsequently became an ancient city and the mausoleum a Christian cathedral with a Venetian campanile. A religious building from the time following the triumph of Christianity that Emperor Diocletian had pursued without mercy. It was John of Ravenna who transformed the ancient mausoleum into a cathedral. Ascending and through open windows, there's a good view of the bell tower. The upper floor provides a magnificent view across the entire city, as well as the harbour. The city has seen much transformation since the emperor first had his palace built here, as in his day the sea came right up to the southern wall. The well-preserved lower vaults of Diocletian's palace were used as warehouses to which ships delivered goods directly from the sea. An ingenious system of pillars, corridors, arches and vaulted ceilings support the palace. Over the centuries, its large basement rooms remained almost untouched. A staircase leads up to the city. Here it's easy to see how the buildings and their sea-facing facades are connected. The historical center of Split is a cultural work of art. The palace, sea aspect and bay, a harmonious blend of both ancient and medieval times. About 5 kilometers north are the extensive but rather unspectacular ruins of ancient Salona. But more than 2,000 years ago, it was the metropolis of the Roman province of Dalmatia with a population of around 60,000. In the 7th century, the city was conquered and destroyed by the Slavs and Avars. Salona never recovered. Omish is situated in the mouth of the Chitina, and the Adria, its strategic location, helped it to develop as a port. However, not for trade, but as the home port for the dreaded Slavic tribe of the Neretlians. They were pirates who brought their ill-gained booty here. Protected by rocks, river, and coast, they even made Venice pay tribute to them. However, in 1444, the pirates were crushed by the Venetians. Undefeated, this powerful city republic purchased it from the last Hungarian-Croatian king and used it as a bulwark against the Turks. The view from the Starigrad fortress high on the mountainside highlights the fact that it was built in the perfect strategic location. Everything can be seen from here. Anything approaching from the sea would be spotted immediately. In contrast is the small harbour town of Makarska, with its picturesque alleys, steps, squares, and stone-built buildings. The well-maintained harbour promenade, with the sight of yachts lying at anchor, is ideal for a stroll both day and night. Now the pirates of old are long forgotten. A journey along the Makarska Riviera is an experience for all the senses. The fragrance of the pine forest on the coastal road along the mountain slopes, and the region's typical coastal towns. Here there are many peaceful bays with beaches of fine gravel and sand. These former fishing villages are now attractive holiday resorts, their natural charm having preserved their original character. From Ploče, ferries transport passengers and vehicles across the Neretvansky Channel to the offshore islands of Pelješac and Korčula, which are among the most attractive in the Mediterranean. The city of Korčula is located on the edge of an homonymous island on a small headland. A great place to watch the boats that travel the Adriatic coast and well protected behind fortified walls. The great explorer Marco Polo is said to have been born here. However, there's no documentary evidence for this. The view from the tower of this building to the maze of roofs of the old town is overwhelming. History, wherever one looks. And the island itself is extremely beautiful. Green and deep blue sea all around. Secluded, captivating bays. Even the Greeks of the ancient world came here and named the island Black Korčula, as it was covered by dense forests. Particularly well known is Moreshka, the wild war dance of Korčula, which has a long tradition. It is performed by acrobatic dance formations with sharp and shiny sabers, reflecting Turkish hostilities. The struggle of the Orient against the Christian Occident. Our journey ends in Dubrovnik. This, the historic pearl of the Adriatic, is one of the world's most fascinating harbour cities. The city of stone had its heyday in the Middle Ages and was one of the most important economic and cultural centers in the Mediterranean. Despite much foreign rule, the city largely succeeded in being autonomous. Its well-conserved historic monuments attract large numbers of visitors. Dubrovnik's historic center possesses many treasures, such as the Onofri Fountain and the St. Spas Chapel and the Franciscan Church. Although the great earthquake of 1667 destroyed the church, when rebuilt, it was even more beautiful than before. A truly splendid and remarkable sight. The adjoining Malabaraja Monastery was built in the 14th century, the oldest part of it being a splendid cloister. This shady courtyard is framed by 60 splendid stone columns. that our filled-in channel that once separated the island from the mainland became Strarun, the city's main street. The climb up to the impressive 13th century city wall results in a magnificent view. Ragusa was subsequently renamed Dubrovnik, and due to its magnificent location, unique old town and beautiful buildings, it's become tantamount to an amazing work of art. Croatia is a country of many faces and timeless Mediterranean beauty. A magnificent place in the sun, where history reflects itself in the Adriatic, and Occident meets Orient. A Balkan paradise.